Oh, bless him. Hallelujah.
Say something. We'll give him an opportunity first, and then we're going to ask that the city council president will come and wrap it up. So let's give them a hand, amen, as they come. Excuse me. As she come.
Exactly. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I just came to say that he is a she. Piper Moore. Good morning. I want to send you special greetings from our mayor, Michael B. Coleman, and to welcome all of you here to the city of Columbus, Ohio. So welcome on behalf of our mayor, Michael B. Coleman. I also want to give a special thank you to Pastor and Elect Lady Lee for extending the invitation for our mayor to join you on this day. And on the mayor's behalf, I want to bring forth the proclamation for this day. Whereas the mayor of the city of Columbus, Ohio, has the responsibility to recognize occasions of outstanding significance, and whereas Bishop John W. Lee started the Lord Jesus Christ Church in Milo Grove in Columbus, 1972. Bishop Lee was presiding bishop over the Newborn Lighthouse Church organization from 1988 until 2007. Upon his passing in 2007, Bishop Winford Turner of Bruce, Mississippi became presiding bishop. And whereas, after many years of laboring separately, as the Newborn Church of God and True Holiness, and Lighthouse Church of Apostolic Faith. In 1988, the two organizations began having joint convocation meetings together, and whereas the 2015 28th Annual International Holy Convocation will be hosted by the North Central District Churches located in Canada, Kentucky, Ohio, and Illinois, beginning Sunday, June 28th through July the 3rd, 2015. And whereas convocation consists of registration, morning and evening services, and breakout sessions, the convocation is scheduled to be held at the Renaissance Columbus Downtown Hotel. The Lord Jesus Christ Church in Columbus, Ohio is the local host church. And now, therefore, I, Michael B. Coleman, mayor of the city of Columbus, Ohio, do hereby proclaim June 28th through July the 3rd, 2015, as the 28th Annual International Holy Convocation Week in Columbus, and urge all members of our community to join in recognition of this significant occasion. Thank you. President Ginther, can you come to the microphone, please?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, and welcome to our wonderful, beloved city of Columbus. How many folks have been to Columbus before? Well, I hope I'm not so presumptuous to say welcome home. We are thrilled to have you in our wonderful city. You've heard from our amazing mayor. I'm a little biased, but he's the best mayor in all of America, the longest serving mayor in our city's history, and the longest serving African-American mayor in all of America. First, I'd like to give honor to God, with whom all things are possible, to Bishop Winford Turner, Bishop Nathaniel Williams, the bishops of the board of directors, and indeed all of those joined here today. We hope you enjoy your convocation here and that you come back every year to Ohio's capital city. I want to take a brief moment to recognize Pastor Carl Lee and Mama Lee of the Lord Jesus Christ Church here in Columbus. Pastor Lee and his much better half, Maria, are two passionate advocates for the Milo Grogan neighborhood just north of where we join today. My colleagues on City Council and I worked with Pastor Lee, who also chairs the Milo Grogan Area Commission, to help fund the construction of a new playground and brought a brand new recreation center to make sure that our young people in that neighborhood have safe places to gather and to play. Pastor Lee has also been supportive of our city's economic development efforts in the neighborhood, and we thank him for his important work, that of the Lord Jesus Christ Church. Over 500 new jobs are being created right in Milo Grogan that don't just pay a minimum wage, but a living wage for the people of Milo Grogan. As I said, the City of Columbus welcomes the participants of the 28th Annual International Holy Convocation. We hope those of you from the participating congregations from beautiful Canada, Kentucky, Illinois, and Ohio enjoy your time here in Columbus. And during any downtime, I encourage you to take and spend all the money you have in our beautiful restaurants and shops and stores and hotels. For families, Parents Magazine is named our co-sire, Center of Science and Industry. It's the number one science museum in the country. This little one looks like a science genius right in front of me. She's got to get to COSI. Or how about the Columbus Zoo, America's best zoo, with one of our greatest ambassadors, Jack Hanna. For sports enthusiasts, we have the Columbus Clippers, minor league baseball team right down the street in the beautiful Huntington Park. Are there any soccer fans, the Columbus Crew, playing right up the road in Mopfrey Stadium? And of course, I don't know if any of you all watch football, but we tend to be a little bit of a football town. Since we have America's undisputed national champion, the Ohio State Buckeyes. After your time here this week, and based on the show of hands earlier, on your second or third or fourth visit to Columbus, we hope this is a special week where you are able to be nurtured and your spiritual life enriched, so that you may return home to wherever home is, Chapel Hill, Somerville, wherever home is, and know that we as the people, the city of Columbus, we're thrilled to have you with us to join in this incredible journey that God has blessed us all to enjoy. I have a resolution to present to the leadership and the bishops. But thank you so much for being here today, and God bless you during this Holy Convocation.
President Ginther is the next mayor, so that he'll be the best mayor in the land.
Thank you. forms, structures, and pattern as for the work of art or machine, and in our case, mankind. So, if I was to ask everyone today, what is success? What is success? What is success? What is that? What does it look like to you? Can I get three hands? Success. Amen. Can I get someone else? Brother.
Success is someone that is prosperous in what they do.
Amen. Anyone else? One more. Have the victory in whatever your hands touch. Amen. Many people think success is having cars, homes, jobs, and material things. I like this one that says success is what things is what you make it. We all have the ability to be successful. So let's look at Genesis. I can tell you, success is not power. I can tell you, success is not money. So when we look at the dictionary, success gives us many definitions, wealth, fame, power, and all that. But I beg to differ. I disagree with that. I like to go to the book, which is the Bible. The Bible will tell me and direct me about being successful. Okay? So, Joshua 1 and 8 says, "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all." No, some. Just a little bit. Maybe I know one scripture. No, it says all that is written therein. For them thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. The scriptures are given by the inspiration of God. So I'm sticking with that. How about you? Okay, let's look at this. God created man. But before he created man, God set the stage. God created a perfect environment. See, many designers, like the automobile and airplanes and things like that, they were designed before we had a perfect environment to use them. There were no airports when they designed the first airplane. When they designed the car, there were some roads that maybe wagons traveled, but it wasn't like it is today. Not that our roads are so good, but it is what it is. So God took his time and God created light, and he had day and night, and he made the firmaments, and he created the waters and separated them from dry land, and had the earth and the sea. And God, you know, he created light. He had a lesser light and a greater light. He had the moon and the sun. So he had, and he created all the animals, and he had the garden and all of that. Prior to created man. So he set the stage. He created an environment for him. So God, everything that he created, what did he say? It is good. If God says it's good, then it's good. So he created this environment. And then he said, let us create man. Let us. Some people would have it that there was two people up there, or there. But see, what God did was consult with his own wisdom. So he said, let us. Now, if God consults with his own wisdom, can he go wrong? Can he go wrong? So, if we want to understand success, where do you think we should go? So if we go to God, knowing that he's the creator of all things, and there's no failure in him, we can't go wrong either. Because he is perfect in everything. Amen? So, here we have God that says, let us create man. But here's the thing. He just didn't create merely man. It just, God said, no. I want to create man in my own image. His image. So, think about it. We have a perfect God. We have a God that created all things. We have a God that set the environment just for man. And he said, let us create him in our image. So, no one, do you really know what God looks like? But his image we have to think on is the characteristics of God. Amen? Because if you remember, Jesus said, if you see me, you see the Father. He also said, I pray that they be like us as one. So when they see you, when they see me, they should be seeing God. Now, what has that got to do with success? Well, that is the beginning. Because remember, success is not that material things that we have all been brought up to believe. But we have opportunity for success. And we have people in the scriptures that clearly donates that. For instance, let's look at Abraham. Let's look at Abraham. See, God will depict and display and gives us examples of success. We don't have to try to figure it out. We just got to believe what God says. So we got Abraham. He told Abraham to do what? He said, come out from among your people. There's a city I want you to go to. So he brought him out of his own people. He said, a city that's not made with hands. He was looking for that promise. And God gave Abraham promises. And Abraham was obedient to God. Now, did Abraham have some flaws? Of course. Do we have some? Of course. Look at Enoch. Enoch walked upright before God. So much that God took Enoch with him as examples. Why? Because he was obedient to God. We have Noah. He even after God said that he repented that he made man, but through his love and kindness, he gave us another opportunity after we failed, not God. We failed. Because God's design is mankind is successful. And God cannot lie. And God does not make mistakes. Because man, we are a free moral agent. We have the ability to make decisions, but we do not always make wise decisions. So we have Noah. Then we have, let's look at David. David was a man after God's own heart. David made mistakes. But David knew how to talk to God and repent. It was in him. It was not superficial. And then after that, we go on to understand that there was many more. We have Joseph. He governed over the land of Egypt. Now, you would look at that and say, oh, that's success. Yeah. But you have to look at it from a spiritual sense. And that's where we will find our success. We're not going to find our success in material things. God has opened a way that we can be successful by choosing the right path. And that path is the holy path. That path is the path that will get us from earth to glory. Psalms 139 says, I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Now, you have David then gone through some stuff. You have David that has fought Goliath. David has killed the bear and the lion. And David was merely a sheep keeper in the beginning. A little ruddy kid out in the field with sheep. And one would look at David from a natural eye and say, how is he or could he be successful? But God laid the path. And see, that's what we have to remember, that it's not us to lay our own path. God will lay the path if you choose him. Seek him first. Seek ye first the kingdom of heaven. See, we have to seek God. God has already made the way and paved the way for our success. We have to claim it. No different than God has presented the Holy Ghost. But we have to claim it. And the Holy Ghost is not our success. It's the beginning of our success. Now, some people kind of got tripped up on that one. Because a lot of people think you got the Holy Ghost, you done made it, but you haven't obtained yet. See, you have the tools, okay? You have the means, amen, to start your journey towards success. Without the Holy Ghost, you're not on a journey of success. I can tell you that now. Because number one, you do not have the power to be successful. And after the Holy Ghost, power shall come. So you can make right and righteous decisions. I'm thinking about Job. God said Job was a perfect man. He was upright, just. That's another example. Can God say that about us? Can he say that about us? See, God has given us such a cloud of witnesses that we can look and say, wow, that's a testimony from God. I want that type of testimony. But I know, think about this. I know and I believe that I can be perfect. And you look at me and say, wow, you're a man. You're merely a man. How can you be perfect? But I'm not being perfect in your eyes. I'm not even being perfect in my own eyes. But I want a testimony from God that says, I am perfect. I am just. And I am upright. See, we as people, as in mankind, we have to reverse our way of thinking. See, we came out of an environment knowing that we was born in sin and shaping in iniquity. But we have to reverse that. And we can only reverse that through the Lord Jesus Christ and his spirit. So that's why I say to you that before the Holy Ghost, you're not on the path of perfection. See, despite what a lot of folks have been telling us, and I'll speak for myself, because I was not always saved. See, I had conversations in time past, and that conversation was not a pretty conversation. I've realized and recognized that later. But during the time that I was having my conversation, that was the best thing that happened to me. So I thought. But then one day I began to, not even understanding why, attend the true church of God. I had seen my wife and my children go. And I said, see you later. You know, have fun. No, I didn't really say have fun. I really didn't. But I was being nice as I could, as I knew how to be in the state that I was in. But I thought I was on the path of success, to being successful. I had a job. I had a home. I had a family. What more could a man ask for? But then one day I went to the house of God, not understanding or realizing why I went. Because all those years, about 15 years, because that's when my wife, she was saved about that long, I resisted. I challenged her in every way that I knew how. So one day I just got up and went to church. And I began to sit there, and the man of God was preaching, and hey, I was not really paying attention because I didn't know why I came there in the first place. I guess I was trying to make a showing. But then the man of God said, anyone who wants prayer, come on up to the altar. Now, I didn't have anything against prayer because my grandparents raised me in the church and they was about prayer, okay? Didn't have much truth, but they did pray. So I sat there and I said, okay, I just got up. And the thing about it, I didn't even really think about it. Before I knew it, I was on my feet. And I kneeled down at the altar. And as I kneeled at the altar, I remember maybe one or two words coming out of the man of God's mouth. The next thing that I remember, I was on my back, sliding about 15 feet maybe, on my back, crying like a baby. It looked like a roach on his back. Everything is moving, legs, arms, tears. Okay? And I'm telling you this for a reason. At that point, I start going towards being successful. I didn't know it at the time. But I knew that God or something, and I had to go back to God, was real. Because I fought it too long. And I lost control. See, one knows when you are doing it and when you're not. And I wasn't doing it. It was God. I got scared, but I got scared in the right way. I had a fear and reverence for God. And then I turned to God. And not short after I got baptized, rebaptized, I should say, because I was baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. And I said, I'm Baptist born, I will live Baptist, I'm gonna die Baptist. But when God slid me across the floor, saints of God. Hallelujah. I then started my way towards success, not even understanding or not realizing. I began to, like David said, I will praise the Lord at all times. His praise should continually be in my mouth. Because he had done something that no one could do. My wife had never seen me cry. My children had never seen me cry. I didn't care. It was a relief. And then I became a real man. One that fears God. And wanted to walk upright in all his ways. Filled with the Holy Ghost. Now I'm in the way. I began to walk in the way. This holy way. Now I'm headed towards success. See, God has set this thing up. And when we look back at the definition of subdue and dominion, see, God gave us that as mankind to take our rightful place. But I could not take my rightful place until God filled me with his spirit. See, God, remember he told Adam to have dominion and subdue? That means to take over, to govern this land. And see, Adam lost his position, mankind. Let me read you something from Isaiah. And this is where mankind, little did he know, was in store for something else. Isaiah 9:6. Because, see, God didn't change what he said. He said, have dominion and subdue. For unto us a child is born and a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government,